and welcome to part one of our Conditional Access Authentication Strengths video series. Today we're going to talk to you all about the power of Microsoft Entra ID's authentication strengths. We're going to talk to you about why we built it and how you can use it. I'm Grace Picking. I'm a product manager in the Microsoft Entra ID customer engineering team, and today I'm partnered with Inbar.
Hey everyone, my name is Inbar Caesar-Kubrinski. I'm a principal product manager on the identity and security team in Microsoft Entra, working on conditional access and MFA. To kick us off, can you just tell us a little bit about what is authentication strength?
Yeah, sure. So over the past few years, we've been banging the drum to get our customers to enable MFA. And we all know that your password doesn't really matter. But there's one thing to turn on MFA, but not all authentication strengths within multi-factor authentication are the same. And as a result, we've heard from our customers and the security community, and by assessing the threats that are out there, that we need to empower our customers to define exactly what type of authentication strength a user must need to abide by in order to be allowed access to corporate resources. And the main difference here is when we talk about phish-resistant credentials. And so it's really all about why you should try and enforce your users to move away from the likes of SMS and phone call to things like FIDO2. And we're going to talk to you a little bit about how you can enforce this for your users, as well as why, and also how you can monitor that for your users.
To talk a little bit more about authentication strengths and why would you want to use it, the classic example that I like to give is that some resources in the organization are more secure than others. And in the past, we allow customers to require MFA when accessing any resource, but as Grace mentioned, we do need to start differentiating between the criticality of those resources. So for example, if we're talking about the cafeteria menu, I can allow my users to access it with just a password and SMS, or even just a password, right? This is not as secure as other information that I have in the company. However, when I'm talking about my most critical assets, the most secret sensitive applications in my organization, this is where I want to require phishing resistant authentication. And this is where I want users to start using those methods, FIDO2, Windows Auth for Business, and certificate-based authentication. So we can start with jumping into an end user demo to see how the user experience is. Okay, let's take a look at an end user experience. The user is going into Office 365 portal, and they're going to sign in with just a password and SMS. Now, the next thing the user is going to do is actually trying to access and do some MS Graph calls. So they're going to the Graph Explorer to test it out. But on Graph, we are actually requiring them to use phishing-resistant authentication. And at this point, as you saw, the user was, although they were already signed in, they were prompted to use FIDO2 key. And as you can see, they were able to authenticate and get access to MS Graph. Okay. So now let's take a look at the admin experience. And here I'm going to start with the familiar conditional access policy creation experience, where you can, of course, choose the name of the of your policy, decide which user you're going to assign this to, which target resources, what are the most secure applications that you're going to require authentication strengths for, and of course, add the set of conditions that we have, like the user risk, like location, and so on. Now, what's interesting for us here is under the grant control, we can choose require authentication strengths. This will basically allow us to choose between a predefined set of authentication strengths. And in the product, we provide three options. Multi-factor authentication, which is basically equivalent to the required multi-factor authentication grant control that you already know. Passwordless MFA, which includes methods like phone sign-in with Authenticator app, Windows Auth for Business, FIDO2, and certificate-based authentication. And finally, phishing-resistant, which is a subset of the passwordless MFA and include FIDO2, Windows Auth for Business, and certificate-based authentication. if we, this is the different levels that or strengths that we have created, but if our predefined strengths does not answer your organization's requirement, you can actually create your own authentication strengths. So here you can see here under authentication strengths, I have the three built-in that I just mentioned. But if you want to be more specific, you can create a new authentication strength. Again, give it a name, description, and choose from the different combination that we offer today in the product for authentication. So you can choose, for example, passkey and password plus SMS if that's what you're if that's what you're looking for. We also allow advanced options for both passkeys, which is formally FIDO2, and certificate-based authentication. With the passkey or FIDO2 AA GUIDs, you can basically require specific GUIDs to require specific keys from specific manufacturers and specific modules. So you can decide that beyond just requiring phishing resistant, beyond just requiring FIDO2, you can say, I only allow this specific model. And we have something similar for certificate-based authentication, where you can define which certificate can be used in order to access the resource. And that could be based on the certificate issuers and the policyoids. So we can be even more specific than just the authentication method.
So this is fantastic granularity. It means that not only can you as our customers choose to use what we've recommended as authentication strengths, you can create your own policies of authentication strengths and even go down to defining through the AA GUID what types of FIDO2 or passkey provider you want to have in your organization. For example, I know customers that have very specific requirements against government regulations and things like FIPS, where they actually need to do an additional set of reviews on a provider for a FIDO2, for example, to make sure that they're compliant. And that's where a customer can use it here. So if a customer may or may not have those requirements in bar, how do we recommend, if they're starting out and thinking about how to use authentication strengths, what's our recommended strategy for assessing how a customer could and should design and deploy authentication strengths policies?
That's a great question. Let's go deep dive into some of the policies that customers like to deploy. So let's take a look at how customers are thinking about the different authentication strengths policies and how they take them into consideration in their overall conditional access policy strategy. So one thing we heard from multiple customers is the idea of thinking about the different type of applications that they have in their organization and classifying them by their impact or sensitivity as low, medium, and high, and deploy policies that align to each of those categories. A great way to do this is actually by using application filters, because that allows customers to tag those applications as they onboard new applications to their environment. And then they don't actually need to go back into a conditional access policy and update it for each and every new application. It's just automatically added once they tag those applications. Now, customer can think about for low, for example, they might require MFA, that's like the baseline, they want to require it for all their application, but as we go higher and higher in the sensitivity, they can, for example, remove telecom from their MFA option, and when we talk about the more secure applications, this is where we go to phishing-resistant authentication. You can take other conditions into consideration, like the device compliance, like the location that the user is coming from. These are different policies based on the criticality of the application. In addition to that, there is additional layer that is cross-application. This is things that you want to act on every time. So for example, if you have users that are high risk, you may want to block them no matter which application they're accessing from or where they're coming from. For bootstrap and recovery, we're seeing customers using temporary access pass, and I'll talk about it in my next slide a little bit in more details, but ability to restrict the bootstrap and recovery of additional authentication methods. And finally, we see customers who want to at least start with phishing resistant method for their admins, especially with PIM. So now that PIM support authentication context, you can actually require which authentication method is required when a user is activating their role with privileged identity management. And finally, vendors and external users, we'll talk about them as well. So the next one is we'll deep dive into is the idea of using temporary access for both and recovery. So today, without any additional restrictions, temporary access pass can be used across all resources protected by ENTRA. However, customers do like the idea of using temporary access pass only for the bootstrap and recovery. To enable that, they would create one policy that allow, let's say, phishing-resistant authentication across all applications. And specifically for the security info, allow, let's say, phishing-resistant and temporary access pass, which will allow a user on their first day to get a temporary access pass, go register their phishing-resistant method, and from that point on, start using those methods across the board.
So this is great, not just for user onboarding, but also in the event that somebody loses access to something that's been registered against their account for security information. It means they can go in and really prove they are who they say they are, even if they've lost access or don't have it to start with.
Yeah, exactly. The next one that I want to talk about is external users. So we now allow you to accept MFA from the user's home tenant when we're talking about external users, which is great for end user experience, right? They don't have to get MFA prompt on their home tenant and then on the resource tenant. Authentication strengths add additional layer of security where you can say which method they have to use in order to access your resource tenant. So for example, as Contoso, for example, I want to say everyone from Fabricam can access my tenant as long as they're doing or using phishing resistant authentication method on their home tenant. So the combination of cross-tenant access settings, in addition to conditional access authentication strengths, allow you to do that together. If you don't have the cross-tenant access setting enabled, you can still use authentication strengths and allow guest users in your resource tenant to use different or require specific method. However, that is limited to some of the method, only to the method that are currently allowed on the resource tenant, which is SMS, push, voice, hardware and software also tokens.
This is fantastic because a lot of my customers, they want to move out of the business of managing internal accounts for external identities, but they're nervous about moving to using external IDs because they don't want to lose any security controls. So here they've got the best of both worlds. They're reducing that management overhead. They don't have to look after the username and password, but they can still enforce using conditional access, accepting MFA, and equally having a good user experience where they're not potentially double prompted.
Exactly.
Well, thank you very much for joining us in our part one video. In part two, we'll talk in more depth about the sign-in experience of the user and how conditional access policies actually evaluate and implement authentication strengths on the user, as well as the resulting sign-in experience. We'll then also move into troubleshooting how you as an administrator can understand if a user is having problems with their authentication details or sign-in logs within conditional access if they're being disrupted, as well as how you might monitor the usage of authentication strengths within your organisation. Thanks for joining us. We look forward to seeing you in the next video.